of thee are spoken, Zion city of our God. He whose word cannot be broken, formed thee for his own abode. On the rock of ages founded, what can change?
We are in Revelation chapter 3, so if you want to turn over there. We will go down that road. I happen to have a few more handouts in case you forgot yours or something along that line. Anyone need one? Well, then, here you go. Okay. Well, now you do. Well, now you do, so you're good. Nope. True that. So far, we have taken a look at the letters, the messages that Jesus has sent to the churches in Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamum. I always have to take a look at them just to make sure I'm not forgetting one. Thyatira and Sardis. And this evening, we're going to be starting in verse 7 with the church in Philadelphia. Just a little bit of history about the church or the city of Philadelphia. It was established about 189 by a fellow king by the name of King Eumenes the second of Pergamum. Anybody here know what Philadelphia means?
Brotherly love.
Brotherly love, or, you know, that kind of a thing. It was established by this particular king in honor of his brother, whose loyalty earned him the nickname Philadelphos, literally meaning one who loves his brother. The reason that there was such a bond between these two brothers is that actually the other king, Attalus II, was really the older brother, but the younger brother was the king over the area. What the older brother had done is he had actually kind of tipped his hat to his younger brother to be the king, and out of a gesture of brotherly love. And so Eumenes then ends up naming or establishing this city, naming it Philadelphia in honor of his brother. One of the purposes or reasons for establishing the city of Philadelphia anyway, however, was because it was bordering on a couple of kingdoms, Phrygia and Mysia, it's been thought by several historians and so forth that maybe one of the grand reasons was to be able to propagate the Greek culture, to Hellenize these two other countries and so forth. And that sort of maybe, it's a possibility, fits into something of what Jesus is going to be talking to the Philadelphians about, the church in Philadelphia at least. It was also a city of earthquakes, causing people in that area to, as soon as they felt an earthquake, to quickly abandon their house. Why? Most of them were made out of stone. Yeah, and so you'd get out of the house real quick. And especially right around, I think it was 17 AD, something like that, there was a major earthquake that occurred in this particular part of the world. And although the other cities, it was such a major earthquake, an awful lot of the cities around the area actually kind of got destroyed, as well as Philadelphia. But they kind of rebuilt, but the problem was that apparently the epicenter was like Philadelphia or somewhere pretty close to it, And they continued to have aftershocks for years afterward, which meant that every time they heard a felt a tremor, what did everyone do? Bolt out of the house. And once again, this may have something of a little bit of a tie to the reason why it is that Jesus, for example, says that I will make you a pillar in my temple. Because what do pillars not do? They don't leave. They don't have to run. And that may be part of the reason why it is that way. I don't have any pictures of Philadelphia. I actually went online and looked around and see if I could find some of the ruins of Philadelphia. The only ruins that actually exist, as far as I can figure, are ruins from a church that was built in the 400s AD. So that's not really going to help us get a real good firm grip on what things might have looked like. The only other ruin that they are aware of is maybe a piece of their theater. That's about it. Why would that be? Why is there so little of Philadelphia, the old Philadelphia? Earthquakes. Earthquakes that made everything just fall down. All right. All those things said, let's read verses 7 down through 13. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, He who is holy, who is true, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one opens, says this, I know your deeds. Behold, I have put before you an open door, which no one can shut, because you have a little power, and have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Behold, I will cause those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie, I will make them come and bow down at your feet and make them know that I have loved you. Because you have kept the word of my perseverance, I also will keep you from the hour of testing, that hour which is about to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. I am coming quickly. Hold fast what you have, so that no one will take your crown. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will not go out from it any more. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. How does Jesus begin to describe himself? As holy and true. That's how he begins it. What is the intention of him describing himself as the one who is holy and true? You can cheat if you want to. It's all right.
Because he is.
Okay. It is a description of who he is, but very specifically, he describes himself as being holy, which, of course, is something that is very specifically aimed at the divine.
Set aside for that very purpose.
Yeah. And actually, a great many of the references that we're going to be kind of taking a look at here as we look at the church at Philadelphia, many of them end up coming out of the book of prophet Isaiah. An awful lot of them do. And as they come out of the book of Isaiah, anybody remember what probably the primary way of describing God in Isaiah happens to be? The Holy One of Israel. That's one of the main ways in which God is referred to in the book of Isaiah. Not only that, but even the Messiah in the book of Isaiah is frequently referred to as the Holy One of God. All those things being said, clearly Jesus, in describing himself this way, is trying to emphasize what? His divinity. That's what he's trying to describe here.
And don't you think, too, fulfillment of prophecy?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. Without a doubt. In fact, I would even go so far as to say that may have more to do with the true part, the holy and true. Because, of course, as we were reading through here, what appears to be one of the great centers spirits, I guess you could say, of opposition to the church in Philadelphia.
The synagogue.
Because that's the only thing that's really mentioned here. I mean, false doctrine's not even mentioned here. The only thing that's really mentioned is the synagogue. And here he's saying that it's not really a synagogue of the Jews. It's really a synagogue of Satan. They're lying, saying that they're Jews, which we'll talk about more in just a moment.
Does that mean they actually worship Satan, serve Satan, or does that just mean they were disobedient?
Probably has reference to the fact that they were disobedient. I don't think, I mean, to be honest, I think it's really only been sort of kind of recently that people have decided to say, yeah, I want to worship Satan. but people have oftentimes fooled themselves into thinking, I don't worship Satan, and yet, by what they do, they certainly are. But in any case, what is the big difference? What's the major difference between Judaism and Christianity?
Well, the Messiah has come.
The Messiah. Christians believe in Jesus as the Son of God. The Jews, not at all. They don't believe that he's the Son of God. They don't believe this Messiah. And the idea basically here is whenever he is talking about himself as being the Holy One, the true one, in specific, he's probably making reference to the fact that he is the true Messiah. Because what was the synagogue saying about Jesus of Nazareth? False Messiah. He's claimed it, but he's not really it. How do you know that? Because my rabbi said so. That's kind of, if you ask most Jews, that's kind of what they'll say. They won't be able to give you a reason why. It's just because my rabbi said so. But in any case, he's declaring himself truly to be the true one. But even beyond all of that, Scripture here says that he is declaring himself as having the key of David. What in the world does that mean?
Well, David, in a sense, started a kingship which God said would never end.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. Let me direct your put a ribbon or a finger or whatever you got there in Revelation chapter 3 and turn over with me to the book of Isaiah chapter 22. And there's kind of an interesting little section here. It's one of those things that most of us would just kind of pass right over, I suppose, because it didn't maybe seem to be all that particularly relevant, except that there's a faithful steward and an unfaithful steward and so forth. But look to verse 15, chapter 22, verse 15. This is, by the way, during the days of Hezekiah. Hezekiah was one of the good guy kings of Judah. He was of the house of David also. The scripture here says, "Thus says the Lord God of hosts, come, go to this steward, to Shebna, who is in charge of the royal household. What right do you have here, and whom do you have here, that you have hewn a tomb for yourself here? You who hew a tomb on the height, you who carve a resting place for yourself here." I'm sorry. I was paying attention to something I shouldn't have paid attention to. Verse 17, "Behold, the Lord's about to hurl you headlong, O man, and he's about to grasp you firmly and roll you tightly like a ball to be cast into a vast country. There you will die, and your splendid chariots will be, you shame of your master's house. I will depose you from your office, and I will pull you down from your station. Then it will come about on that day that I will summon my servant Hilkiah, the son of Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah. And I will clothe him with your tunic and tie your sash securely about him. And I will entrust him with your authority, and he will become a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. then I will set the what? Key of the house of David on his shoulder. When he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one will open. I will drive him like a peg in a firm place, and he will become a throne of glory to his father's house. Kind of a little-known passage, but clearly there's a connection here, right? And by the way, this story is also, or at least we see references to this Eliakim, son of Hilkiah, in places like 2 Kings 18 and so forth as well. We can see that he is the, shall we say, a little bit like maybe the grand vizier, prime minister, something along that line, to Hezekiah. And he has been, according to Isaiah, he is given here this key on his shoulder. Apparently that was a mark of authority, to have a key that would be put on your shoulder. Which, by the way, also reminds us, doesn't it, of Isaiah chapter 9. You familiar with Isaiah chapter 9? Well, turn and look there too. It's actually, this is one that gets quoted a lot this time of year. Starting in verse 1. But there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali with contempt. But later on, he shall make it glorious by the way of the sea on the other side of the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. You shall multiply the nation, you shall increase their gladness. They'll be glad in your presence as with the gladness of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you shall break the yoke of their burden and the staff on their shoulders. The rod of their oppressor is at the battle of Midian. For every boot of the booted warrior in battle, tumult, and cloak rolled in blood will be for burning, fuel for the fire. For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, an idea of a key on the shoulder, you see. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Who's this talking about? Jesus, the messianic prophecy, right? And did you notice the government will be on his shoulders? That key idea. And that's kind of what we're talking about here, referencing whenever he talks about the fact that that Jesus is saying that he will have this key of David that will be given to him. And when that key is given to him, if he closes it, nobody opens it. If he opens it, nobody closes it. What do you suppose that means, Charles?
Well, it's a repeat of chapter 1, verse 18, in the living one, and he said, "And I was dead, and behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades."
Yeah. It's Jesus that has the keys to a lot of stuff, as a matter of fact, right?
Yeah. In Matthew 16, 19,
that's right. He's handing them over to Peter to be the one to open the gates, as it were, on the first day of Pentecost.
Key, you can keep people out, and you can let in who you want to let in.
So who's getting let in and who's being kept out? All right. Those who are forgiven are let in. And rebellious, disobedient, are kept out. Remember the passage in John chapter 10 where Jesus is talking about himself as being the good shepherd? Yeah. And even beyond all of that, he ends up referring to himself as being the door. Yeah. The door to the fold, sheepfold. And he says, once again, I let people in, or sheep in, I let sheep out. And no one gets in except people maybe that are trying to go over the fence, but all of those are what? Thieves. And they won't get in. I really hadn't thought about it till I was studying for this week, but that makes a pretty good sermon for those of you who like to preach. You know, there's a lot of folks that are trying to get into the kingdom of God in lots of other different ways, but there's only one way, isn't there? That's through Jesus. So. That's right. That's right. I got the key. I've got the key.
Even in the parable where in being invited to the royal wedding, mm-hmm. the king said, "Go out and you know, in essence, not force them in, but
beat the bushes.
Do everything you can." Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So there were rules to the game.
And some people didn't abide by them.
Urging you to come to the feast.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So, this is the way that Jesus is describing himself. He's describing himself as the one who is holy, the one who is true, and the one who holds all the keys. And his message, he starts off by telling us what he knows. Which isn't terribly unusual because he's pretty much told everybody this before. What does he know? I know your works. I know your deeds. I know what you've been doing. Now, when Jesus says, "I know what you've been doing," that might cause a few of us to go, gulp. hopefully not. Hopefully it causes us to go, "Well, I hope you're pleased, Lord." But in any case, he says, "For you, I've got some open doors. I know your deeds. Behold, I have put before you an open door." What does an open door usually make reference to?
Opportunities.
Yeah, opportunities. We can take a look at the Apostle Paul, and he kind of, you know, uses that reference frequently. 1 Corinthians 16:9, 2 Corinthians 2:12, Colossians 4:3. In every chance here, as he talks about an open door, what is he making reference to? Usually to evangelism. Yeah, so he's kind of, you know, at least with Paul, as he talks about this sort of thing with an open door, he's talking about evangelistic opportunities. And maybe that's what it is. We don't know that for sure, but it certainly would kind of, you know, given how this phrase is used in other places in Scripture, that would seem to be true. And especially as we end up thinking about the reason that historians believe that Philadelphia was originally established. What was it again? How come it was originally established? To be able to Hellenize these two other kingdoms of Mysia and Lydia, I think it was. So in any case, this was sort of what their mission had been back at 139 when they were established. And perhaps this is also kind of what's being referenced here as well. But there may be one other open door as well that we really haven't gotten to yet. Well, I mean, we read through it. But may also be one of the reasons he's talking about having an open door. But about this open door, you'll notice that he says no one's going to be able to shut it. And he follows that up by giving them, by kind of describing them. How does he describe them? Little power. As a general rule, what do you suppose it means when he says you have little power? Church, you have little power. What's he saying? Yeah. Maybe they're not very numerous. Maybe they're not very influential. Maybe they're not very wealthy.
But he says here they've kept his word and not denied his name.
Well, that's right.
So that's a positive aspect of it.
It is a positive thing. And notice how all this stuff is kind of grouped together. Let me read this again and just kind of notice how this is kind of all grouped together. I know your deeds. Behold, I have put before you an open door which no one can shut, because you have a little power and have kept my word and have not denied my name. What does that say about having little power?
It goes a long way, evidently.
Yeah. Can, I mean, in comparison, the church at Rock Hill might be considered a congregation that has little power. There's not a whole bunch of us. Anybody here like a senator or, you know, mayor or anything? Nobody is. We're not that influential. Maybe we don't have all the power in the world, except that do we have all the power in the world?
Yeah.
On our side, yeah, we sure do. Who is it? How? Well, I gave it away, didn't I? What is it? It's not a what, it's a who. It's who God is. And what was it that was going to keep this door open for this congregation with little power? What does it say here? You didn't deny my name. That's what he says. You kept my word, which means what? You've been obedient, and you have not denied my name. What does it mean to deny the name of Jesus? I think that's a worthwhile question. What was that again?
Turn your back on
Jesus. Turn your back?
Or not to acknowledge him as Lord.
Not to acknowledge him as Lord. Or
to diminish his commands.
Yeah. Yeah, because there's an awful lot of practical atheists, even among people that are religious. Did you know that? How can you be a practical atheist, though you might claim to be a believer?
Well, you can call yourself anything you want to, but it boils down to whether you're obedient or not, right?
Everything kind of boils down to what you do, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You can claim to be an atheist, I'm sorry, claim to be a believer, but if you're living like you don't believe in the Lord at all, what are you really? You're a practical atheist. And if you say that you believe, but on the other hand, you live as if Jesus were not anything more than just another historical footnote somewhere, who are you? Well, or what have you done? Kind of denied my name. There's lots of ways we can deny him. Jesus, whenever he was on trial, had to sadly witness Peter in his stuff and notice what Peter said. And of course, Peter was actually saying, I really don't know him. I don't know him at all. But there's lots of ways that we can also deny Jesus, sometimes through our words, sometimes through our actions, and sometimes even through our silence. We can deny him that way as well. So there's lots of ways that we can deny him. But they hadn't, and apparently they had been pressured to do so, but they had not given in. They'd remained obedient to his word, and they had not denied his name. And because of that kind of faithfulness, there was a lot of things that were very positive that were about to happen. One of them is that they were going to have this open door of opportunity. We don't know exactly what it was. Usually it has reference to evangelism. So maybe there was some sort of evangelistic opportunity that was coming their way. Why? Because they were obedient and they didn't deny the name. But there might be some other things here as well that might be useful for us to take a look at. I got behind here a little bit. Let me catch up. Looking down to verse 9. Behold, I will cause those of the synagogue of Satan, who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie, I will make them come and bow down at your feet and make them know that I have loved you. Now, if we were all politically correct here, that would sound an awful lot like anti-Semitism, I suppose. But what is Jesus trying to say here? And the silence was deafening.
Well, I think he's communicating. Apparently, this synagogue of Satan probably was viewed as a deterrent or as an obstacle that these Christians had to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus is saying, in effect, you do what you're doing, I'll take care of them.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I've noticed in talking with other people and even in my own prayer life that we have a tendency when we're asking a favor of God to tell him how to solve the problem.
Yeah.
And most of the time when God solves the problem, he really doesn't do it the way we told him it ought to be done.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think there's a real lesson there, and I think he's referring to that here, that I got this.
Yeah.
I know all about them.
Yeah.
I know what you're doing,
mm-hmm.
and we're going to take care of it.
Yeah.
You just keep doing what you have been doing.
Yeah. Let's take a look at a few passages, because I think it's important to ask this question or answer this question. How could someone say they are a Jew and are not, but lie? Mark your Revelation passage here again, of course, and turn with me over to the book of Romans. Look with me over to verse 9. Let's look down to verse 6. Now, of course, I hate just looking at one verse because you kind of miss the context. And I don't want anyone to think I'm just trying to, cherry pick stuff. So read the context. But for the sake of time, let's read what verse 6 has to say. Paul says here, but I didn't do it. All right. But it is not as though the word of God has failed, for they are not all Israel who are descended from Israel. What? What is he making reference to? What's he talking about here?
They're not living the faith.
Well, that's right. Let's take a look down to verse 23 as well then. And he did so to make known the riches of his glory upon vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory, even us, whom he also called not from among the Jews only, but also from among the Gentiles. As he says also in Hosea, I will call those who were not my people, my people, and her who is not beloved, beloved. And it shall be that in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, there they shall be called sons of the living God. What's Paul saying here? Especially if you put it together with verse 6, in the larger context of what it is that Paul is trying to get across.
Well, I mean, Paul's main purpose was to take the gospel to the Gentiles.
Yeah. Because basically what the thrust of chapters 9, 10, and 11 in the book of Romans basically boils down to is Paul is justifying his ministry to the Gentiles. There was a large Jewish contingent, and he was Jewish himself. There was a large Jewish contingent that were saying, Paul, what are you doing teaching the gospel to these Gentiles? And there were others as well beyond all of that, and it's kind of shown up in verse 6 there. It's not as though the word of God has failed. Israel was expecting that all of Israel was going to be saved, which, of course, he does kind of make reference to in the latter part of chapter 11, but he explains what he's talking about But they're saying, so if Jesus really is the Messiah, how come all of Israel isn't falling in lockstep and believing and stuff? What's going on here? And basically, Paul is saying, listen, I know this sounds confusing to you, but not all Israel is of Israel. Not, and who was Israel, by the way? What was Israel? Another name for them is the people of God. God's people. So let's go ahead and paraphrase this so we understand it better. Not all of God's people are Jewish. That's what he's trying to say here. And that's what he says starting in verse 23 as well, where he says, you know, the way this falls out is that God was willing, because God has that kind of power, he can make any choice he wants to. In fact, that's kind of the bulk of what he's saying in chapter 9 here. God can make any choice he wants to, and just in case you hadn't noticed Israel, you kind of had broken the covenant. So God can make any kind of choice he wants to. You know what kind of choice he's made? The choice he's made is he's now going to start including the Gentiles. And as he includes the Gentiles, guess what? They become the people of God, just like you were. And that's the point here. And that's why it is that he is saying back in Revelation that these folks, these Jewish folks, this Jewish synagogue in Philadelphia, he was saying, you're a synagogue of Satan. You say you're Jewish. You say that you're Israel, the chosen people of God. But it's a lie. Why is it a lie? Because now God has changed the rules. It's not about being circumcised anymore, is it? Now it's about believing in Jesus. Now it's about believing in Jesus. And as you've decided, some of you Jewish folks, because not all of them had, some of them had believed, but as you Jewish folks have decided to go ahead and live with, I'm the chosen among the chosen people because I'm circumcised and still believing in Jesus, guess who you're not anymore? You're not the chosen one of God. That's why it's a lie. But there's something interesting that's going on here besides all of that. Because he goes on to say, need to get back to Revelation here. He goes on to say, I will make them the synagogue of Satan, the Jews. I will make them come and bow down at your feet and make them know that I have loved you. Now, we don't know exactly what the percentage was of Jew to Gentile in the church of Philadelphia, but my guess is it's probably primarily Gentile, probably. And here was an ironic twist. If you were to go over to Isaiah 45, I'd like to ask you to turn over to Isaiah 45. If you didn't know where some books in the Bible were before tonight, you might now. Isaiah 45. I'm sorry. Verse 14. Yeah, that'll work. There's also one in chapter 43. Well, there's several passages here that kind of talk about this. Yeah, turn to 43. That's the one I was looking for. 43 and verse 3 in particular. But I'm going to start in verse 1. But now thus says the Lord, your creator, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You were mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I have given Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in your place, since you are precious, verse 4, in my sight, since you are honored and I love you, I will give other men in your place and other peoples in exchange for your life. It's that last section here in particular I wanted to get to where he says, I have loved you. Because notice what it says here in Revelation. It makes note of the fact that these Jews were going to bow down, very much like we just read a moment ago. We're going to bow down and know that the Lord loved these Christians here in Philadelphia. Can you see the interesting irony here? In the Old Testament, it was said that the Gentiles, who didn't know God, were going to come to the Jews, to Israel, and come to them and bow down before them and know that God had loved them. But now what's happening? Everything's been flipped around. There's irony here. Because now the Gentiles, at least those that believe in Jesus, had become the chosen. And these Jews who had, because of their unbelief, had become unchosen, were going to do what?
They were now on the outside.
Yeah. They were going to bow down. Yeah. And know that I have loved you. And that's the reason I was saying, when it talks about this opportunity, this open door of opportunity, it could be that there's talking about, certainly about maybe evangelizing to the other areas. But what other option is now just opened up to us? Maybe there was going to be a large-scale conversion of the local synagogue. And that was what he's making reference to when he says, I have just opened up a door, and nobody's going to shut it. I don't care how small you are, how powerless you might feel, how little you might feel. This door is going to be open, and because of the fact that you've obeyed me, because of the fact you've not denied my name, this is the reason that door has come open. And I'm going to let it happen. Without a doubt, Charles.
There's another reference in Isaiah 49:23. Kings will be your guardians and their princesses your nurses. They will bow down to you with their faces to the earth and lick the dust of your feet, and you will know that I am the Lord. Those who hopefully wait for me will not be put to shame.
Yeah. And there's lots of other passages that are very much like that in the book of Isaiah, which are basically talking about how it was that sometime in the future, and guess when that future was happening? First century. When the Gentiles would come in and they would be seeking the Messiah and they would become a part of God's chosen people. That's the idea that's involved here. But you know, there's even something more here. Did you notice, in light of all these things we've talked about, look down at verse 10. Because you have kept the word of my perseverance, I also will keep you from the hour of testing, that hour which is also about to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Apparently, there was going to be a rather large period of tribulation that was going to be happening kind of pretty much region-wide, maybe empire-wide, I don't know, but largely region-wide. And yet, Philadelphia was going to be spared. Can you imagine perhaps one reason why they might have been spared the testing that he's making reference to here? Maybe because the synagogue was frequently in opposition to the church. And what was about to happen? The synagogue was about to get converted. And so maybe that's a lot of it. He says you're going to be not necessarily going to be tested like the rest of the world's going to be tested. By the way, what is a test about, generally speaking? Those of you. That's right. Learning what you're supposed to learn. Was there any evidence that perhaps the church in Philadelphia had learned what they're supposed to learn? You've kept the word of my perseverance. You have continued to be obeying me. You've not denied me. You've already passed the test. There's no need for you to be tested anymore. So I'm going to spare you that particular testing. Now, of course, that's not to say necessarily that, you know, we as Christians are going to somehow or the other, any of us are going to skate free. You know what? God forbid it should happen, but people keep talking about a big recession and so on and so forth. My guess is most of us are going to feel the pinch if that happens. But we will, as you were making reference to a little bit earlier, hopefully, because we have a kingdom in heaven, we can keep our eyes on things above. Are we going to be taking it as hard as the folks that are hardcore materialistic? Not by a long shot.
Mm-hmm. When my son John came back from Scotland, he came to Dallas. We were lived in Arizona then, but he moved to Dallas, went into business. He was a professional photographer. And he went through a period of time when, you know, things got pretty rough. Had his equipment was stolen and so forth. And one of his friends came to him and said, John, I want to talk to you. You've got something that I want. You've got something that I don't have. Hmm. And what he had been observing was how John was handling the things that would make the rest of us go bananas, maybe. And that was a perfect opportunity for him to tell him about the Lord.
Exactly. Exactly. So,
and I think that's probably why these people are going to be coming to these Christians here in Philadelphia. They can see that they've got something that they don't have and
yep.
they want.
Exactly so. But he says, in addition to all that, I'm just trying to condense it because I'm running to the end of my time here. He says, I'm coming quickly, and by coming quickly, he could mean a lot of different things, right? He could mean I'm coming like the end of the world, or he could mean what else?
Well, he's talking about all the turmoil that's going to happen in the world, so probably, you know, we think this was written somewhere around 90-ish.
Yep.
So we know Jerusalem had been destroyed in 70, just mm-hmm. 20 years earlier. And
yeah.
So
turmoil going on in the world.
Yeah,
it's entirely true. So maybe that's the sense in which he's making reference to that. But one way or the other, he says, because I'm coming quickly, hold fast to what you have so that no one will take your crown. And by the way, this is the Stephanos crown, which is the crown of victory. He who overcomes, he goes on to say, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will not go out from it anymore. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes out of heaven from my God, and my new name. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Basically, he's talking about being a pillar. He's talking about not ever leaving. And the whole idea, okay, we're going to see this happening several times, to have one's name written. Common phrase that we're going to find in Revelation that has the tendency to mean ownership or alliance with or change of status or even identity. You might recall that those who have 666, you know, what does that mean? They belong to the beast and to Satan and his minions and so forth. But to have God's name written on us as a pillar in the temple, what does that mean? We belong to him. We belong to him. All right. Any questions about stuff we've taken a look at? Spent a lot of time in Isaiah.
You know, Brother Morris knows for his, according to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, the way that he does that is those that have been obedient in baptism have received the Holy Spirit. So that Holy Spirit is how the Lord knows those who have been, according to 2 Timothy.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to shift over to devotional mode. I'm sure you noticed we read through it and I made brief reference to it about Jesus saying, hold fast what you have so that no one will take your crown. It is important to notice here that we're told in other places that nobody can take us out of the Lord's hand. His love isn't going to be steadfast. He's not going to let any of us go. The only way that we will ever be gone is to leave him. And that's kind of the idea behind don't let anyone take your crown. It's not going to happen by persecution. Well, I guess it could happen by persecution, couldn't it? Someone could persecute us individually and might cause us to say, I'm done with this, I quit. I'm not going to go that way anymore. But you know, it's not always the outside stuff, it more often is the inside stuff. Very much like with the story of Israel, right? King Balak wanted to be able to destroy Israel, so he called in Balaam. Balaam tried to curse him, but it didn't work. But Balaam had a secret weapon. The secret weapon was, tell all the street callers, the street girls, to go down and party with the Israelites, and that will make them cave on the inside. That's the way that our crown can be taken, by either giving in to the persecution or deciding to be disobedient. Don't let anyone take your crown. Jesus has the key. He's the one who controls the door. And this evening, if you have not become a Christian according to the New Testament pattern, we encourage you to do that this evening. And Jesus will gladly open the door and let you in. And if you're already in the fold, don't try to get out through sin or through denial of him. If for any reason this evening you need to repent or you need to come to the Lord, we encourage you to come forward while we stand.
Just things of thee are spoken, Zion city of our God. He whose word cannot be.